Ladies and gentlemen, people of the internet, welcome back to yet another episode of Crypto Over Coffee. I hope you're doing well today. And if you're new here, every Saturday we break down the latest news and the hottest topics in the world of technology and cryptocurrency over a cup of delicious coffee. That being said, in today's episode, I'm talking about a few underrated crypto projects that I'm looking at across various ecosystems, the YubiKey bio security key, our usual 404 logic not found segment, and more. So make sure you stick around for all the updates. If you like crypto, please subscribe to the YouTube channel or hit the bell notification button. Or if you're on the podcast platform, please do follow me there. You'll get a heads up whenever I post new episodes of Crypto Over Coffee. Just a friendly reminder as well, please be aware of scammers that are in the comments posing as me and other crypto YouTubers. They're also on a various other social media sites pretending to be me. I don't have a WhatsApp. I'm not going to reach out to you on Telegram. I'm not going to reach out to you in the DMs. So if the comment on YouTube doesn't have the name highlighted like you see here, it's not me. So you can go ahead and report them. So please be safe out there. And in partnership with the folks at Keystone, I give away a Keystone tablet steel seed phrase backup device in every episode by picking a random comment from the video. And just for transparency, the product is only available in select regions. So if you win and you're from an unsupported one, I'm just going to send you Bitcoin instead. So the winner of last week's giveaway by random comment draw is shown here on the screen. Congratulations to you. I'll be in touch to help you claim your prize. And of course, thank you for leaving your comments on my videos. Really, really appreciate it. So as we always do, let's go ahead and kick things off with a bit of a crypto market update. And then we'll dive into some of these altcoin projects and crypto projects that I alluded to in the intro. The cryptocurrency markets have recovered from the hefty drops that we've seen over the last couple of weeks here and there, right? And while Bitcoin has not made its way back to its previous all-time highs, it is still holding strong around 60 to 61,000 at the time of recording, at least. Markets move fast, so this might already be outdated. Ethereum, however, did pop off this week. It hit a new all-time high, basically out of nowhere, rising above 4,400 USD and close to 4,500 per ETH. Today, as I film this video, the markets are in the red zone by a little bit, maybe 1%, continuing the trend of sort of the weekend being a flat time for crypto prices. However, using data from Trade the Chain and Santiment, two places that I use to make sort of educated data-driven guesses about where crypto prices are going based on on-chain and off-chain metrics, these things indicate to me that Bitcoin and many other coins might be coiling for another leg up. Based on a few things, right? The sentiment starting to boil over again. The selling pressure is subsiding on a lot of coins. We shall see, but I'm hopeful that we'll see 100K Bitcoin and altcoins to follow before the end of the year. All right, now let's talk about some altcoins and projects that are underrated or have news that's not getting enough attention or ones that I just started researching recently. And let me remind you again that this show is not about buying tokens. It's not about pumping the price. It's all about learning. So I'm not telling you to buy or promising you profits. In fact, some of these tokens might already be pumped, might already be up and not ripe for buying in. So please be safe, don't FOMO, and have good risk management in place. Informational in nature only. To say this project is underrated might be a stretch, this first one, but I feel that they need to be mentioned nonetheless. And I've covered them a few times now on the channel, and I've been very clear that I did get a chance to buy land in one of their early sales, just for transparency's sake. But one of my favorite metaverse projects, NetVRK, just closed their insane transport NFT sale, which I think did like $15 million in sales. And it featured futuristic and freakishly awesome design vehicles for their virtual world. Now you're probably like, okay, Hashoshi, thanks for nothing. You're sharing a sale that's closed. And that's a great point, but also pretty apt because this channel, like I said, is not about getting you to buy stuff. The reason I bring this up is to point to the very reason that I support this project in the first place. They are cranking out quality assets and working to bring this thing to life for real. In light of news that Facebook rebranded to the name Meta to double down on its focus on VR and the metaverse, it's even more important that open, decentralized projects like NetVRK are put in a position to challenge for precious market share in the space. I mean, NetVRK is building not only a high-quality virtual reality world, or world of worlds, but also an ecosystem where digital assets can live across a variety of blockchains like Ethereum, Polygon, Elrond, Cardano, Polkadot, and more. These are all listed on their website, mind you. Beyond that, the very focus of the project is to provide opportunities for everyone to monetize, to create, to be a part of this, not just the wealthiest token holders or landowners in the world. To be creators and consumers in the virtual universe that Network is building, you just have to participate. The focus is placed on putting the user in the driver's seat, not a company or a team behind the project. And my hope is that there will be ways for people all around the world to monetize their activities and creations in the metaverse, for example, using Network's creator tools to create in-game items that people can purchase with cryptocurrency, and people will be able to own their items as digital assets on public blockchains. Personally, for me, I'm excited to have another platform in which I can meet people, educate people, share content, and I will have my very own Hashoshi HQ or headquarters in the virtual world of Network when everything goes live. So make sure you stay tuned for more details on that. Really, really excited about that. Every once in a while, I also find a project that I feel is underappreciated or flying under the radar and one that piques my interest at a philosophical level. And today is one of those days. The project in question is called Archway, which is a smart contract platform built in the Cosmos ecosystem, which you know I'm a fan of. Now, Archway is tackling a problem that I think is just now starting to become clear to more people, and that is the tricky subject of how developers of decentralized applications and protocols are rewarded for their work and contribution to an ecosystem. There are countless examples of developers either being grossly underpaid or underrewarded for creating something huge, and many more still of developers being a bit greedy and taking more than their fair share for all intents and purposes. Archway intends to flip that model for dApp developers and eliminate the need to come up with complex and controversial tokenomic schemes that are prone to errors just to adequately compensate developers. So Archway itself is a Cosmos IBC or inter-blockchain communication protocol compatible platform that will let dApp developers deploy widely interoperable applications to the Cosmos ecosystem. That said, on that blockchain platform that Archway is built, there's also mechanisms for dApp developers to be rewarded for their applications' contributions to growing the network. First of all, the gas fees or the protocol fees paid to use Archway and to make transactions to dApps will be split between validators on the protocol and dApp developers. At first, it'll be a 50-50 split, but these parameters will likely shift depending on how the economic patterns evolve. This alone is a drastic shift from gas fee burning that you see on Ethereum, or allocating 100% of gas fees to validators. If you think about it, it makes sense to reward dApp developers for their undeniable share of the work in driving transactions that feed gas fees paid. That's kind of hard to say, sorry. Without dApps, not a lot of gas fees are going to get paid, right? Because there's not a lot of transactions. And so that brings me to the second source of income, which is the inflation or new supply of the native token, which is similarly split between dApp developers and validators, theoretically a 25 to 75% split. So the tokens released into circulation by way of network operations are yet another way to incentivize developers in the same way and by the same logic as those gas fees. And now the last one here will be controversial, but I can see many use cases where it could be valuable, and that is contract premiums. And this essentially is a premium fee that a developer can assign to a smart contract that the user will pay at the same time as the normal gas fee on the platform. However, this fee would go towards some premium feature or functionality like expedited transaction processing, for example. Some may immediately point to how this feature can be misused by greedy devs, and I don't disagree, it will inevitably happen. But game theory and customer behavior has a way of weeding out the scammers in this way. This feature could very well be used for lots of good things as well, lots of cool features. But most of all, I want to point out that Ethereum and many other networks like it need to implement features like this for core developers, because they're critical to the growth and staying power of a protocol. That's been top of mind for me lately, and one of the ways to stop attrition from core dev roles is to pay these people adequately. So overall, I wanted to share Archway not because it's only a cool platform to build on, which it does seem to be. It's kind of a thought leadership experiment on developer compensation and how you can align incentives on the network to bring developers to build cool things. So awesome stuff. Folks in the Cardano ecosystem will also be pleased to see development efforts being aimed at building stablecoin offerings on the Cardano platform. with one such project dubbed Ardana having raised $10 million from seed investors this past week. Ardana is building a DeFi primitive that could be a huge catalyst for other projects on Cardano after launch, offering stablecoin issuance, borrowing, savings, and more. And I'm by no means saying that Ardana is the only stablecoin game in town, but it's a great example nonetheless. That said, you might wonder why I'm making a point to talk about stablecoin ecosystem plays, because it's not all that exciting to talk about a fiat-pegged asset, am I right? I mean, the reason I'm talking about this, though, is because stablecoins are prerequisite for any type of DeFi success on a layer one chain or ecosystem. I mean, look at Cosmos. Terra Luna's UST stablecoin has been a large part of the growth in and around that ecosystem, and it's only just now getting linked up with the interoperability protocol in IBC. On Ethereum, USDC, USDT, DAI, all these stablecoins drive huge, huge volumes of liquidity to markets in the DeFi space. You absolutely need stablecoins to succeed in DeFi. Without them, you can't do DeFi. So I'm hoping that Ardana and their peers in general succeed in their mission to bring stablecoins to Cardano. And this next project here is one that the community has been pushing me to look into for a while now, and I finally did so. If you ask me enough times, I will eventually look at something. I'm just super busy. But that project is Relay Chain, which provides powerful cross-chain bridging between major blockchains like Polygon, Ethereum, Binance Smart Chain, Avalanche, and more. And if you've been in the crypto space for a while, you know that bridges are all the rage now, enabling movement of assets from one blockchain to another and back again for DeFi and other purposes. Of course, you want them to be audited. There's risk in bridges. Just be warned there. Relay Chain offers these bridges for a bunch of different blockchains, but it's the whole mechanisms underneath that really, really interest me. First of all, for those who provide liquidity to the platform in a given pair, they are rewarded not in some synthetic or the Relay token, they're rewarded in the native fee-bearing token for the platform pair. More specifically, I mean that if one provides, say, a Relay and AvaX liquidity, they earn AvaX for that liquidity provisioning, helping that user build its investment in a given ecosystem and not just the Relay token. This often cuts out a step or two for folks who would otherwise end up having to trade to AvaX on a DEX afterwards. One could argue that this also pairs well with the fact that Relay token native to Relay Chain is then sort of relieved of that constant selling pressure on DEXs as liquidity providers move to shift from Relay to whatever other cryptocurrency they're trying to get exposure to. Relay Chain has also done a lot of work to support major blockchains, with Polkadot and Cosmos on the way as well, which I'm most excited about. And that'll do wonders for users in the existing Avalanche, Ethereum, etc. world that want to get exposure to these interoperability networks and participate in DeFi, but haven't yet had the opportunity to do. And the strategy, of course, is to partner with DeFi mainstays like QuickSwap on Polygon, for example, to give users of that protocol an easy on and off ramp to the network and other blockchains, which is similar to what the main competitor, AnySwap, has been doing. Now, it's early days here, but Relay Chain could challenge AnySwap for precious market share here. And I would love for you to let me know in the comments if you've heard of Relay Chain, if you've used it before, what your thoughts are. Really, really want to hear from you. So thank you in advance. Now, I've been waiting and wanting to make this segment for the last 2 weeks, but I promised myself I wouldn't make this content until I really had some time to test the product first. And if you've watched my show before, you know I swear by YubiKey hardware security keys. They're my go-to tool for security. And they just launched the long-awaited YubiKey Bio device in their 5 Series lineup. The YubiKey Bio, as you might have guessed from the name, incorporates biometric fingerprint scanning as a means for authentication using your YubiKey for login, 2FA, and all the rest. This feature is arguably the most requested feature that I've seen in all my time covering YubiKeys, and it is now here and available. For me, having owned literally every YubiKey since the company launched its very first key, they've come a long way in their product quality, the feel of the product, how well put together it is. And the YubiKey Bio is the most well put together piece of hardware that they've made. And the recent 5C NFC is pretty darn great. So that is saying something. The key itself comes in USB-C or USB-A, depending on what model you choose. And it can do all the things the YubiKey should do, from FIDO or FIDO2 auth, 2FA, OTP generation, using YubiKo's own authenticator application, and all that good stuff. The biometric side of it is just icing on the cake, giving you yet another option to secure your key and keep it from being used by an unauthorized party. The fingerprint data itself, by the way, is stored on the same secure element that manages the cryptographic operations and keys used for signing. So you can also rest assured that your biometric data is safe from snooping. Now, this is the shortest of the short review, I know, but I wanted to share this with you because I love their product so much, and I think every single person should own at least two of these. One is a primary, and one is a backup in case you lose the primary. So if you want to get a YubiKey bio, you've been waiting for fingerprint scanning, you can get one for $85 using the link in the description and the pinned comment below. And by the way, if you're also looking to round out your internet security and privacy lineup here at the end of the year, one of my go-to VPN services, Surfshark, hooked me up with a coupon code for their holiday deal. So starting November 1st, 2021 through December 31st, the code Hashoshi will get you 4 months for free on top of your paid plan instead of the normal three. There's no pressure whatsoever, but if you're shopping for a VPN, why not? Figured I'd share. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for 404 Logic Not Found. And for those of you who are as of yet uninitiated in this little firecracker of a segment, I highlight notable tech-related fails or otherwise just stupid moves in the world that need to get some attention. Speaking of attention, if you want to help this episode of Crypto Over Coffee get some attention from the algorithm robots, please hit that like button, get subscribed, follow the podcast, do whatever you can do to tell those robots that you're enjoying the content, that others might also enjoy it. It really helps. So thank you for that in advance. The topic of today's illogical extravaganza is the surreal announcement this week that Facebook would rebrand to the name Meta, reaffirming its strategic alignment towards building the metaverse, the digital world of worlds. And this is no surprise. After all, Facebook has been posturing for this for years after acquiring the VR mainstay Oculus, and the countless times Zuckerberg has talked about the metaverse in public talks over the years. But what really surprises me is the number of people I've seen, particularly in the blockchain and crypto space, celebrating this as some sort of victory for the true metaverse projects that exist in the world of decentralized tech. Make no mistake, one of the largest technology companies plunging headfirst into the metaverse ocean is validation that the idea has legs and that there is and will be demand for it in the future. But the fact that Facebook is the one doing it is not something to celebrate, in my humble opinion. Of the big tech companies, there are few, if any, that I would trust less to build a digital world that I would have to inhabit than Facebook, I guess now Meta. I expect whatever product comes out of this to be a privacy nightmare, mining data from users to a degree we have never seen before, commercialized to degrees we've never seen before. And could I be wrong? Yes, I could be wrong. I'm wrong all the time, and I try my best to admit it when I am, but this is my theory, at least. Furthermore, I fear that if Facebook, now Meta, is the first to deliver a user-friendly experience and onboard the first billion users to the metaverse, it will hamstring any chance of decentralized alternatives being adopted in any meaningful way. And that scares the heck out of me. The metaverse should be an open, borderless world of infinite creation for everyone, not a world owned by a mega corporation. And when I see people in the blockchain space celebrating this move, it scares me even more because I genuinely don't think people realize the pressure that this puts on others that are building in this metaverse space who have far less resources to work with, and they are bootstrapping users from scratch, whereas Facebook has tons of users already. The competition is now very real. The stakes are now very high, and higher than one might think in regard to what the evolution of the metaverse will one day be. If you're celebrating this Facebook Meta move as a win for the metaverse concept, I implore you to see the 404 logic not found in this scenario. And if I'm wrong on this Meta thing and they prove me wrong, I will gladly accept it. But for now, my feelings stand. 404 logic not found. Alrighty, my friends, it is time for sponsor time, which helps keep my coffee cup full, which I have conveniently not touched this entire episode because I get so distracted talking, but it helps keep the show coming to you every weekend. So thanks to the sponsors. First, I want to thank the long-term sponsor of Crypto Over Coffee, Ledin, who offer an awesome BTC and USDC savings account product, collateralized BTC loans, and more. Ledin recently announced an increase to their interest rates for both Bitcoin and USDC with 6.25% APY for balances up to 1 BTC and 2.25% for any balance over 1 BTC. And additionally, USDC interest rates have increased to 9.5% APY on your full USD balance that you have in your account. So I love seeing rates going up based on market conditions. Love it. And now, as part of a new onboarding program for new users, you can get $10 in USDC if you make a qualifying deposit of $75 and leave it in Ledin for 15 days or more. Do so using my link in the description and pinned comment below. So if you want to start earning interest on your Bitcoin and USDC, definitely give Ledin a look. Thank you very much. And I would also like to shout out Platypunks, an NFT project centered around pixel art style platypi of various attributes and a truly engaging community benefit for Platypunk holders in their community art collection. The Platypunks art collection is a unique community benefit consisting of NFT art collection curation that is curated by holders of Platypunk NFTs by way of voting. So as long as you own one Platypunk NFT, you have a vote in the NFT collection, which is valued at tens of thousands of dollars now and continues to grow. When a piece of art is sold from that collection, Platypunks raffles off more than half the proceeds to Platypunk holders. And there's right now going a community scavenger hunt that you can win prizes and interact with the community even more. So stay tuned for that. And there's also a significant announcement coming in the space for Platypunks, I think next weekend. So I will definitely be sharing that. You can check out Platypunks at platypunks.com and see what you think. Of course, I would be remiss if I didn't tell you and remind you that NFTs are highly speculative, they're often illiquid, and there are risks. So please be careful and know those risks before making a decision to purchase any NFT, bearing in mind that there are local regulations and things like that where applicable. So thank you very much to Platypunks for sponsoring a segment on Crypto Over Coffee. So let's go ahead and do some community Q&A as well. I always answer folks' questions from the show on Twitter and on YouTube comments, etc. And I've got some questions from last week's episode that I'm going to answer here. I want to also remind you that if you have a question that you want answered, it doesn't matter what it is, beginner questions are perfect. Leave them in the comments below on YouTube, or you can tweet me at Hashoshi4 as well. All right. So let's go ahead and dive into these questions. All right. We've got the first question here from Pentoshian. Hopefully I pronounced your name correctly. Can you tell what your favorite metaverse and gaming projects are? Okay. So this question is interesting. I'm not going to be able to name every single one because I always do these off the top of my head. So if I prepared this, I could probably give you a longer list, but here are just some off the top of my head. One I mentioned today, metaverse project, network, NetVRK, love it. Sandbox, another one. Love that project. Both of these are great examples of builder-focused projects, projects that are really focused on creating cool experiences. And I think they're just beginning in terms of their growth. Okay, those are two. Chain Guardians as well. Chain Guardians is a really fun game. I mean, people don't realize how cool Chain Guardians is and how it feeds Chain Boost, which is sort of this launchpad platform where you can get access to all sorts of cool things in the gaming space. Chain Guardians is great. I'm friends with them. You know, I've made content about them. I made content about them a long time ago. I've always really liked the project. Avigachi, I think, is a really cool project. I had Coder Dan on the channel fairly recently to talk about Avigachi. They're killing it right now. They've got this, they've had these auctions going on. They've got all sorts of cool on-chain sort of NFT constructs that are just really a great example of what NFTs and the future of NFTs can be. UFO, Star Atlas is fantastic in the Solana world. You've got Crypto Blades on the Binance Smart Chain space. You've got Meta Wars. There's all sorts of cool games. Wonder Hero is one that's absolutely exploded over the last several days, launching staking. I think it's a WND-BNB pair. I did get in early on Wonder Hero just for transparency, so do that what you will. A lot of these coins, right? I'm not telling you to go buy them right now. Okay, let me just be very clear about that. It's very, very difficult for people to grasp this. But when you FOMO in to cryptocurrencies, and I'm answering this question because I want to share things that I think are cool, right? You know, for example, Axie Infinity. I think Axie Infinity is amazing, but going in and buying it right now after it's way up, it's past all-time highs, it's got this huge market cap, you have less room to run, right? Even if it does really well, there's elevated levels of risk. And a lot of the projects that I just mentioned are in the same boat, right? If you go and buy these now, right, you could end up losing money. And that's not what I want. Okay, so just be very careful. These are projects that I think are cool, that I think in varying levels, right? Star Atlas is a long way away from being deployed. Some of these haven't implemented all of their ideas yet, things that I think have high potential. That's the main idea, things that I think are cool. By no means an exhaustive list, so do with that what you will, but there are just a few examples. Thank you for your question. Next question is from Michael Ponciano. Hoping you could shed some light on how to avoid NFT rug pulls. I've been blessed to be careful and cautious, but haven't found myself in a situation, etc. Tips and tools. Can do. There are a few red flags that you can look at, right? One of them is when a project is so focused on marketing and pushing things out, doing like really big campaigns to push it out without any real utility. There's no real community building. If you go into the Discord or you go into the Telegram and there's just all of this like hype, like, oh, you know, this is gonna be a quick flip, you know, awesome. We're gonna, you know, let's push giveaways. Let's get this out there on social media. Let's pay this person to talk about this and let's pump it. That's a big red flag, right? The community should be the first focus. It should be people who are buying into it because of the long-term utility, because of the actual value that it brings to the community. That togetherness is very important. People that are going in there looking for a quick flip, looking to push with giveaways and paid sponsorships and other things, which aren't always bad, mind you, right? Sometimes you just need to get the word out to get people to understand, and then it takes a life of its own. That's not always the case. So if you look at that in the community, that's one way of finding some of those red flags. The other thing is when you have this situation where, and I've seen this happening a lot, NFT projects will buy a Twitter account that's verified or will buy one with a large following, change everything on the profile so it looks new, and there's like no history of tweets, and you're like, well, you know, it looks cool. You're like, oh, they have a ton of followers, it must be legit. It's not, right? So you have to be very careful and just be looking like how much history does this team have? Are the creators public, right? Can you actually point to a person and say, oh, I know this person is doing this? Those are some of the ways. There's no way to avoid it with 100% certainty. And following the pack is also not always the way. If you look at Mechaverse, for example, the art, really cool. The actual tangible stuff, really cool. People have gotten burned to a huge extent on Mechaverse, buying them for, I don't know, 8 to 10 ETH reportedly, and now the floor is below 1, right? So you just have to be very careful. Sometimes even rug pulls aren't rug pulls, they're just overvalued, overhyped. So those would be my main thoughts. There's no 100% way to do it, but do your due diligence, really look at the community, look at the value, the long term. How focused are people on just quick flip profits, and how focused are people on the tangible benefits of holding that NFT? Thank you for your question. Lim Dion, just started investing in crypto. Would like to ask, what should we keep, Bitcoin, Ethereum versus gold, silver? What kind of return do you see in the next 5 years? So I can't promise you a return in the next 5 years. If you believe in the cycles of crypto, then the next 4 years or so around the next Bitcoin halving will likely or hopefully see another cycle of sort of bullishness. That's how people believe this whole thing works. You have new supply constriction on Bitcoin, and that pulls the rest of the market with it. I think gaming, I think NFTs, I think DeFi, and a lot of these other areas are going to make these cycles less pronounced because there's so much actual sort of utility now. There's a little bit more maturity in the markets. It's going to make it a little easier for folks that are in this space to sort of stay afloat, right? Whereas in 2018, there were a lot of people who sold their ICO, they had no product. When people exited and just dumped the tokens, everything was just rock bottom. I don't know that that's going to happen now for some of the top projects. We'll see. For Bitcoin and Ether, I do look at it kind of like that gold and silver pair. Where gold and silver thrive is being this sort of stable rock. Well, they quite literally, I guess, kind of are in some cases rocks or minerals or metals, whatever. They're all derivative of minerals. Gold and silver are going to be this sort of a stable place overall, not 100% rule, but overall going to be a very stable place to park money. Okay, we get that. I think a lot of people still have that in their rotation. Bitcoin and Ether, I think, have a lot more upside. Also, a lot more downward volatility as well. A lot more risk associated. I believe long-term that Bitcoin and Ether and some other cryptocurrencies are great plays. That's my held conviction, a deeply held conviction. I still have gold and silver, and I'm always going to have some gold and silver because I still think that I should have a diversified portfolio. What I do isn't necessarily what you should do. You should think, how much risk am I willing to put myself in? I believe that Bitcoin and Ethereum and cryptocurrencies in general, no matter how much I believe in them, just pose a lot more risk. The markets are smaller, less stable. That's the way it is. So I'm sorry I can't give you a true answer to all of your questions, but I would say you have to have a mix of a bunch of different types of assets because that gives you that peace of mind that if one takes a plunge, you're balanced out across other things. So not financial advice. I'm not a professional, but there's my thought. Thank you. Last question of the day, Filippo Mantovani, I think I pronounced your name right. What's an Ethereum virtual machine? Ethereum virtual machine, or EVM, is talked about all the time, and I know that it is not very well explained most of the time. The Ethereum virtual machine is essentially the mechanism or the execution environment for smart contracts in the Ethereum ecosystem. It is what takes the Solidity programming language, which is a high-level language. You write it in, you know, English characters that you can easily read to an extent. It basically translates those into more low-level language, sort of computer language, if you will, ugly stuff called bytecode. And that bytecode is sort of what executes opcodes or operations on the Ethereum network, right? So the Ethereum virtual machine is sort of this translation layer, execution layer for smart contracts that you write in code to translate that into actual tangible actions and outputs that end up getting written to chain in state or as data, right? That gets immutably written to the blockchain. That's what the Ethereum virtual machine is. If you want to take it at the highest possible level, it's what makes smart contracts work on Ethereum. A lot of projects have, you know, they tout, we are EVM compatible. It basically means that you can execute smart contracts that work on Ethereum on that blockchain. Most of the time, they've either taken the Ethereum virtual machine module and they've implemented it on their blockchain, or they've augmented it slightly, maybe improved it slightly, modified it to make it work a little bit better, and let you do it. When you see a project talking about EVM compatibility, they're basically talking about the ability to run and port Ethereum smart contracts and applications and some of the tooling over to their blockchain without having to change anything, without having to rewrite it in a different programming language. So it's sort of a developer friendliness type of thing to make Ethereum applications work on their blockchain. That's the simplest I can make it. If that answers your question, please let me know. If you need more context, please let me know in the comments below. I want to thank everyone for watching the show. As always, if you have some time to stick around, I will link a couple videos here for you to click if you're interested in learning more about crypto. I've got plenty of stuff on the show and on the channel. And I want to thank you so much for taking the time to watch. Hope you and your family have a wonderful weekend and week ahead. And until next time, cheers.